Hello everyone and welcome to the short presentation about conflict solving. I call it what, why and how. So first of all, what is a conflict? So a conflict is a behavior by one or more persons which bothers another or more persons and really prevents them from doing something they would like to do. Why do we have conflicts? It can be disagreements, it can be bad chemistry, fight about power, lack of respect, cultural insensitivity, and many other reasons which are kind of underlying the conflict, and often of course a combination of them. And then how to solve a conflict. It's easy to start a conflict, but it might be hard to solve it satisfactorily. And what we will see in the presentation here is also how important it is to prevent conflicts, but also to tackle conflicts as early as possible. Being different can also be a big strength. For example, I have a colleague and she is very different from me. And I would say that I'm the one who are getting the big ideas and saying, let's do it, let's do like this, let's start moving. And she is saying, but this is not possible. There are rules, there are regulations, there are details. So while I'm very good in getting ideas and having the overall lines, she is very good in the details. And of course, I can easily think, what an idiot, she's shooting down all my ideas. And she thinks that I'm an idiot because I just blah, 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 and gets a lot of ideas, but they are never possible to do. But when we work together, we are a really good team because I'm the one who's good in getting ideas and she's the one who can really qualify it and make it realistic and make it happen because she sees all the pitfalls and all the details that I might not have seen. And I think that story is something which is useful in many groups because it's really about if you are able to combine your different strengths and your different viewpoints, then you are also much better in solving problems together. Of course, the best you can do is to prevent conflicts. So prevention is better than cure, and that also goes when it concerns conflicts in a group. Sometimes it's not so easy to prevent it, but also remember that the sooner a conflict is identified and handled, the less traumatic it is. But we'll also look at it on the next slide. Sometimes we really tend to be shy. When we have a conflict, we try to avoid it, we try not to speak about it, we hope that it will eventually end. But very often conflicts don't end when we stop talking about them, they just become worse. So it's really important to handle it as soon as you identify that there is a potential conflict. So the best way to prevent conflicts is really by knowing and understanding expectations, opinions and feelings. So one example of an expectation could be two students in the same group. One of them really wants to have a high grade. The other one is happy if he just passes the exam. Of course, there are many potential conflicts here. How good should it be what is being written? Should it be perfect or should it be good enough? How much work should be done? Do you expect people to work 30 hours per week and that's fine, then there is time for friends and partying? Or do you expect your teammates to work 50 hours per week? It can be hard to solve, but at least understanding each other's expectations and discussing them and agreeing about the rules, roles and relations in the group is a very important foundation for this. I would also say that this cooperation agreement, which is written down, is an important part, especially in multicultural and international groups, because that can be different cultures. And when you're saying everyone should meet on time, everyone should do what they promise, this can have really different meanings. But writing it down makes it much more precise and easier to agree on, and also easier to handle if the rules are broken. And then you can say, yeah, you broke the rule, and how can we go about that? So making the implicit explicit is always a good idea in order to prevent conflicts. And also to evaluate this cooperation agreement and your group cooperation in general, regularly speak about how do you feel the collaboration is going? Is there any problem? Do you feel there are any problems or anything you're unhappy about? And then you can actually deal with it in an open manner before the conflicts arise. A good advice to remember is always to be towards others as you wish them to be towards you. So try to be nice, try to be a good teammate, and try to be friendly. Now we'll talk about conflict behavior and conflict solving. So the first part is how to spot a conflict, then talking about personal conflict behavior, about conflict solving, and the consequences of conflicts. So how do you spot a conflict? Actually, it's a good habit when you're working in a group or in a team to always being a little bit aware to see, can you see potential conflicts arising? Because that can help you to deal with them earlier. So when you hear very loud discussions instead of dialogue, that's a sign. If people are not trying to understand each other, but just to show power or to win discussions. Very long arguing without any decisions. When you go for the man and not for the ball. So when you're talking, when it's becoming more personal and not just a disagreement about the topic. When you postulate instead of reasoning. Here's written the formation of cliques. So when you start having small subgroups who are competing against each other or who are disagreeing against each other, when you start having allies in the group who are against each other, and when you start having people talking behind their backs, all these are good signs, or not good signs, but signs that a conflict is arising. And then when you start to see that, it's a good time to step in and try to deal with the conflict. We can have different behaviors when it comes to conflicts. So one profile is the avoidance profile, who is trying to avoid, deny, ignore, turn away from it. There is a profile who is trying to smoothen things out, who is ready to abandon his or her personal goals because really prioritizing relation to others is more important. There is the win-lose, the forcing type of people who really want to win and to demonstrate power. There is the compromising part. All shall gain something. There is different ways to do things. So trying to find a compromise that everyone can live with. And then there is a confronting one. Accepting the conflict, accepting that everyone's needs are legitimate and important, having respect for personal relations, make allowances, but also confronting and saying, now we have a conflict, respecting everyone, but we need to solve it somehow and find a solution to move on. And it's important to be aware, which profile are you? So just before moving on in the presentation, try to think about some conflicts that you have been involved with or that you have been witnessing, and try to see if you fit into one of the categories, or maybe you have elements for more categories, but try to reflect about what kind of person you are when it comes to conflict solving. There are different, more systematic ways to solve a conflict, and it can actually be a good idea to agree on beforehand that if you have a conflict that you will try to solve it using a certain pattern. But of course, no matter which approach you use, it only works if people are really interested in solving a conflict. So I would say that the first step is to make sure, and that is again easier before the conflict arises, that everyone agrees that if there are conflicts, it's about solving them in a good way. So one way can be that those involved in the conflict tell and have time, sit around a table, and they have time to tell about how they have experienced the situation, how they have contributed to creating the problem, and also how they can contribute to creating a solution. Then a mediator, who is the neutral part, and the persons involved participate in the development together of possible solutions. And when saying persons involved here, it can be persons involved in the conflict, but it can also be, say, you have a group of 7 students, you see you have a conflict between 3 of them, and then the other people in the group would also participate in the development of possible solutions, so it becomes a solution for the whole group. The group agrees upon trying one of the solutions, and the mediator writes down the agreement, so there is an agreement, and then everyone evaluates the process and states whether they are satisfied with the solution. I would really recommend here that to find a solution that everyone can see themselves in is really, really important. Conflicts can be negative, but they can also be turn into something positive. It can bring forward different sides of a case, so you get actually different perspectives. I told about the story with my good colleague before. It can enhance creativity and also stimulate learning because you need to take into account different aspects. And also, if you manage in a group to solve the conflict, you are likely to be able to work better together, even better together in the future. So create more trust and a deeper friendship, and also improve the ability to handle conflicts in the future, both in the group, but also personally in the later job situation. So I would say that it's not the conflict itself, but it's more the lack of ability to solve it or the lack of will to solve it, which is really creating the problems. And again, I would underline that if you're involved in a conflict, it's really important that you have a mindset about that it's important to find a good solution in order to solve it. And with this, I will say thank you for listening. Try to think about what you do to prevent and solve conflicts in your group. Thank you.